The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Appreciate everybody's joining in here for today's webinar on the EEPS and the inversion matrices and some results that we've obtained over the last number of months. And I'm just going to wait a few more minutes to make sure that some more people join in before I get started. So just be patient, and hopefully in about 1 minute we'll start the actual webinar. In the meantime, for those of you that are logged on, I would certainly appreciate, just to make sure that the chat window is working, if you would mind throwing in a quick few characters, say hello or whatever, just make sure it's working so I know that you guys can hear me okay out there in the rest of the world here, because I have everybody on mute. Thank you, our friend in UK. Appreciate it. And I see some others have chimed in. Thank you. Excellent. Very much appreciated. Well, okay, let's get started here. Others may join in, but I know your time is precious, so we'll get going on this. So welcome to continuing webinar series on engine emissions, noting that engine emissions are pretty prevalent in the today's news regarding manufacturers in Europe and all the different concerns over proper emissions measurements and meeting the requirements around the world. So We take it to the next level here with this webinar and discussing some of the inversion matrices that we've put together for actual engine exhaust with the 3090 engine exhaust particle sizer. And I'm your presenter today. My name is Bob Anderson, and I'm a global product manager with TSI. And I'd also like to acknowledge my co-author, Aaron Avenido, who is engineer with us at TSI, and he's done a lot of the actual fundamental work on the matrices and gathering some of the results. So I wanted to acknowledge his contribution here today's webinar. So let's get started here. So when we talk about the quick overview of what we're going to talk about today, some motivation and background on what we've done so far and how to get it to the next level. We'll also give some a brief overview of the matrix updates and how we've actually came and developed some of these matrices and some of the comparisons that we've I've seen on actual laboratory exhaust as well as an engine exhaust. And then I wanted to review some of the published results that we've obtained specifically from Southwest Research Institute, Ford, and at CSIRT, who also assisted us with developing the matrix. And in the meantime, if you have any questions as the presentation goes along, toss them into that chat box, and if I can address them right there and then, I will. If not, I will make sure that I will answer them at the end of the webinar. So background and motivation. So over the years, when we started developing the fast particle sizers at TSI, back in the beginning, that we specifically, you know, partnered with the University of Tartu, and they used kind of an empirical inversion matrix in order to look at regular ambient aerosols. And what we found, you know, over time, when we started looking at different engine exhausts, we noticed some discrepancies, as well as some of our customers, that under certain regimes, that you started to see a difference between the larger size particles. And those discrepancies have been reported widely in the journals, specifically with Zhang and Evans and Asbach and Zimmerman, University of Toronto, and others, looking at the EEPS and the FMPS, for that matter, and compared to the SMPS. And if you talk about just what's the general overall, you know, what's the differential or, that we're seeing is that, you know, when you see particles bigger than 100 or 80 nanometers range, we start to see that there is some undersizing that could occur with specific engine exhaust aerosols. And that would really result in you get some narrow size distribution, smaller mean diameter. And potentially, you know, when you start looking at the concentration of those larger particles, you'd have it would be less than it should be, and you'd actually would see kind of what we call as a large particle roll-off above 200 nanometers. So in looking at those data from different sources and collaborators around the world, we decided to take on the effort to look at redoing the inversion matrix and how those particles would be measured. And we first had to come back to fundamentals of just what the EEPS does versus the SMPS. And I want to go through a couple slides there just to give the baseline so people understand exactly what we're talking about. So it's really the difference in the measurement principle is the cause for the discrepancy. With an SMPS, we use a bipolar neutralizer, and that is essentially morphology independent. With the EEPS, they use a unipolar charge state on the aerosol, which can be morphology dependent. And we use that unipolar to get above the background on the noise and electrometer, so we get a better signal-to-noise ratio. And when we look at those charging characteristics of those different particles, that can be complicated due to the initial charge state of the particle itself and then correlating it to a size. So our challenge going through there is distinguishing those large particles that have essentially much more charges from the particles with fewer charges. And when we start looking at those differences, we notice that it is somewhat engine exhaust dependent. And what I mean by that is if you look at diesel exhaust, or you look at gasoline direct injection, or you look at light duty diesel and some of the after treatments that they're employed, they are slightly all different, little difference in the actual charge state of those aerosols. So some fundamentals or background stuff for charging, and we use this slide a lot when we talk about SMPSs, but bipolar is basically dominated by ion diffusion, and it's independent of the morphology of the aerosol, and it's very predictable. And Wiesenholder has gone through and published a number of data points from those types of things. But also, you've got Oh et al. And Awashathi. I won't get the name right, but they're in India. They've done papers on looking at that ion diffusion correction, and also Biscos on looking at the theoretical analysis on DMSs, and that's back in the AS&T manual. If you go with a unipolar, it's a higher charge than bipolar, and it's really dominated by diffusion and electrostatic forces. But you can see some morphology dependency on those things, difference between agglomerates and spheres. And it really has to do with the surface area of the aerosol. And one can imagine that when you look at agglomerates or aggregates of diesel exhaust, what you'll find is that, you know, they're not necessarily all nice spherical type of particles. You've got a lot more surface area, and they're somewhat erratical shaped, but you get a lot more surface area, and potentially the nature of that aerosol, which is more carbon-based, you can have a higher capacitance of those aerosols. And in essentially, when you lump it all together, you on average, you have about 30% more charge on agglomerates than you do on spheres. And that steady-state charge is not necessarily as predictable as unipolar. So just when we look, just want to go through some fundamentals on the EEPS. We look at electrometers on the EEPS, and those electrometers are all time aligned and the image charge corrected, creating that instrument record. And that instrument record is processed in order to determine the particle size distribution. I'm not going to go through all the equation right here, but the essential point that I want to point out here is that you have the second one down, you have H sub J I is the instrument matrix. That is the used by the equation to the left there. And then you've got the particle size distribution of F sub 1. Those are the two pieces I want you to focus on for right now that we're going to be talking about. So when you bring all that information together on the actual charge on the electrometers and converting it to a size distribution, those are the two points I want to focus on right now. But basically, you've got the smaller particles on the EEPS starting at the electrometer 1 at the top. Those come out earlier, and then as you process down through the EEPS, it gets exposed to a different voltage on the center rod below, and then it's really those electrometers that we're talking about in that E electrometer of looking at like 10 and above up to 22. Those are the size range particles where those electrometers actually measure the larger particles that we're focused on. So when you summarize what we've done to date, we've had two new matrices developed by TSI and our good friend and colleague Xiaolong Wang from Desert Research Institute, with some of the help from University of Minnesota Diesel Research. You have Dave Kittleson's, Jake Swanson, and Mark Soltensberg, all very helpful in developing these matrices. And we looked at actually, instead of just, you know, saying theoretically this is the charge and this is the particles like this, we actually did it by empirically calibrating the EEPS to SMPS. That means we ran the EEPS and the SMPS side by side on different aerosol, combustion aerosols, and looking at how those particles showed up on SMPS versus EEPS, and then combined that information together to develop these two new matrices. One we're calling a soot matrix for agglomerates for obvious reason, and looking at particles that are focused on that those agglomerates as well. Then the other one we looked at is the compact matrix, and what we mean by near spherical or compact aerosols, to look at calibration applications as well as aerosols that don't have agglomerates. And just as a reference, that default matrix was developed back in 2004 by Ayato Miramihad from Tartu, and that was all theoretical, basis from that standpoint. So that was the state of the art back in 2004. So when we go through these matrices, we get a polydispersed aerosol generated, and then we have a monodispersed aerosol classified for each EEPS primary channel diameter. And then we're actually measure it side by side by the EEPS and SMPS and CPC. And obviously, we would go with the EEPS data corrected for multiple charges, just like we would in the SMPS, so we understand what the charge distribution is there. And then we go through and enter that information into the inversion matrix, and that's determined. And basically, that inversion matrix, that H component of the equation relates to the size distribution. Remember, it's not monodispersed that's coming through on the EEPS. We're always measuring a polydispersed aerosol for the most part when we look at engine exhaust. And then we look at all the different electrometer currents and offsets and basically come up with that inversion matrix to do correct for the charge on the aerosol and gives you a more accurate size distribution when compared to SMPS. So what does that really look like? And we tried to depict this, in a visual way, so it's a little bit clearer to understand. I always do better with pictures myself. So here for the compact instrument matrix, we have on the left basically the current on the electrometers, and then below we've got the electrometer numbers up through 22. And so we look at the different particle number size or mean particle size on the top here, like 5.6, 13.3, up to 562 on the things. And what you can quickly see is that particles that are smaller wind up in a very narrow band of electrometers from a probability distribution. So obviously, when you're looking at 10 nanometer particles, they show up on electrometers, 3 through 5 roughly, so very narrow distribution, so we know exactly when those size particles come through. It's not the same when you look at bigger particles that could have multiple charges on it. They actually show up, because it's not a variable charge, they show up on a much more or a higher number of electrometers on the EEPS. So for example, if we looked just from a standpoint of, let's use 237, on the sides, the green, nice green line right there. You see that those particles can show up from electrometer 11 on up through to 22. And there's a distribution of those particles that show up from a probability standpoint. So a much wider distribution of electrometers that those aerosols would show up on. Those are for the compact ones themselves. If you looked at the actual soot matrix, it's even more pronounced. So we take that same distribution of for those type of charge aerosols, and it's really pronounced as you go above 100 nanometers. And I'll back off and look at one of them that's 316, and that's once again you have a wide distribution of those aerosols and different electrometer rates, and they kind of have a broadening effect that happens when you look at those soot matrix aerosols. And the smaller aerosols, they also broaden out a little bit more too, because if they're carbon-based solid particles, they've got a little bit more charge than they would than a, like an emery oil or a spherical aerosol from that standpoint. So you see a little difference between the two different matrices visually. So try to keep that picture in your head as we step through some of the results, and I think it'll become a little bit clearer of why these two graphs are important as we move forward in the discussion. So when I kind of bring it all together, in the last slide here on electrometers versus current ones, if we look at two different particle sizes, one's a 42 nanometer and one's a 420 nanometer aerosol compact, and then we looked at a soot-related classified aerosol. So what the good news is that if you look at the smaller size particles, specifically the 42s, looking at the default compacted soot, they all give relatively the same, they show up relatively all in the same electrometers for those types of aerosols, regardless of the matrix. And that's good. That's exactly what we want to have happen. We don't want to impact the size distribution accuracy on the smaller size particles. There's a little difference, small between the soot and the compact, but essentially there's a much better agreement between those three than we had before. Then when we look at the bigger particles, and look at the default versus the compact and the soot, and I really want to point you out to the actual default at 420. Notice that green line with the triangles, and you see this kind of curve and wave and shift and those types of things happen on the default matrix. And that's really indicative of the matrix not on the default matrix, not accurately sizing the aerosol due to the larger soot particles. But when you back up into the actual compact and soot matrices, you find that it's a much more appropriate curve that you would find in compared to SMPS, and as well as the two different matrices. So this tells us that we're right where we need to be in have the right peaks at the right size for these different agglomerates. So now if we take it and actually apply it, what we've learned here to actually measure some aerosols. This is SMPS and EEPS using the soot matrix and looking at different aerosols from engine exhaust. We got heavy-duty diesel engines, we got light-duty diesel, and we've got GDI, and we've got some different speed and loads characterizations here, but let's say discussion purposes here. So let me focus first on the heavy duty side of it. We've got basically a 1400 RPM, and you know, you've got a number distribution here from a standpoint of running from 5.6 up to about 450 nanometers. What you immediately recognize is that the EEPS default matrix, which is in red, is significantly different in the curve compared to SMPS and the EEPS soot matrix. While we don't have necessarily one-to-one with the SMPS and the EEPS soot matrices, you can see there's a drastic improvement on the distribution and the sizing of those aerosols across that spectra. And so that shows a very, very good improvement from that standpoint. But we also see some discrepancies. So like light-duty diesel engine, where the particles are all less than 56 nanometers, while the peaks are more aligned between the soot and the SMPS, there's still a discrepancy on the number concentration, and that could be due to a number of reasons. One, it very well could be that the diffusion losses are slightly different between the EEPS and the SMPS, and the SMPS is actually overcorrecting on the diffusion losses. But nonetheless, you see a much better curve and sizing compared on light duty exhaust. But still not perfect to where we want it to be, so we're getting closer. But on GDI engines, which has been in the news a lot, and as well as next generation engine technology, there is always this concern about getting the right measurement of particles, especially on cold start. So when you start looking at the GDI line here, we really see a huge difference comparatively between the default and the soot matrix. compared to the SMPS. We have this kind of wandering line on the EEPS default line, which is really incorrect. We had a peak at the small size around 10 nanometers, and that's matches up fairly well from what we expectations are. But on the bigger particle sizes, we see an over concentration estimation, and then that roll off kicks in, and we miss those larger particles. So this is all moving in the right direction from that standpoint, but not one-to-one, and I don't think you could get to one-to-one, but this is a vast improvement versus what we had with the default matrix. Here are some results from our friends at Ford. Manny Marique has done some of this work here, and I shared it with us recently. So we're looking at the soot inversion, and this is a light-duty diesel with a leaky DPF on cold start, using the certain version versus default matrix. And what we find here is that the soot geometric standard deviation on the size distribution agrees much better with literature compared to the default matrix, which is at 1.52. We see a small shift in the geometric mean diameter. Moving it a little bit forward, it's hard to necessarily see exactly, but if you focus in on it, you see just above 100 nanometers, you can see that shift on the peak between the default and there. So we're actually see that shift to the right to get the sizing where we expect it to be. And then we see a broadening of the aerosol as we would compare to SMPS. And so you're picking up a much more pronounced sub 100 nanometer size concentration distribution peak here on cold start, which you would not pick up if you use the default inversion. So pretty good difference. The good news is that if you look at total particle number, it's largely unaffected, so we're not undercounting from that standpoint, which is critical for what we're trying to get at on these types of measurements. If you kind of take it to the next GSD on the soot matrix when we compare it to SMPS, and if you compare the two soot versus defaults, what really kind of pokes your eye, you see this kind of I call it the Matterhorn on the default size. You see this kind of curve and peak, and then it kind of pulls back to the left here. You wouldn't expect to see that in nature unexhausted, that sharp of a peak. And it's really more of what you see on the soot inversion on the left-hand side is this more broader peak, broader distribution of the aerosol due to, you've got primary particles joining up with secondaries and actually getting, different size distribution across there in the exhaust instead of these very, very sharp peaks that you would see on the default. And so when you convert this to a mass distribution and compare it to a gravimetric, we find that distribution here and compared to a gravimetric, we'd be looking at, potentially 50% less compared to a filter-based measurement. When we go to the soot inversion and make sure we cap particles, we're now looking at about 10% difference between the gravimetric versus the mass distribution reported by the EEPS. That is much more desirable for engine manufacturers to drill into and compare to manual methods so they can benchmark a lot easier. So if you kind of lump it all together, about a 50% difference with the default inversion compared to gravimetric. But I also want to point out here that these measurements here and that were taken were data that was originally obtained from a CVS measurement, as well as they're done way before that the soot inversion was actually created. So what Matty Marique did at Ford is he went back in time and grabbed older EEPS files and then reprocessed them using the inversion matrix with the new software. So he didn't do any new measurements. He just took the data as is and did a bimodal normal fit to the data and converted it from the default to the soot inversion and compared to gravimetric. And what he found was that you see a huge difference in correlation between the soot inversion and gravimetric over the FTP cycle. And these are about six different GDI engines, different size range, concentration ranges, so we got a pretty wide distribution. He basically went through and looked at the effective density calculations, which Matty is known for, and basically used the 2.3 as a density factor as part of his calculations. And one thing of note here, which kind of shows up pretty pronounced, is that the average dilution ratio in the CVS is about 20, but that's not optimized when you're looking at Lev 3 or Tier 3 levels. So when you start talking about USO6 cycles as well as FTP cycles, they're going to have to go through and actually make a revision to how you optimize the CVS tunnel. So that's why you see some of the scatter on the actual plots here. And so that's real. But nonetheless, they expect to see a much better tightening or less variability on these data when they do optimization on the CVS tunnel. So this is really not a reflection on the EEPS itself. This is more of a reflection on the variability of the filter measurement. But nonetheless, we're getting much better correlation using the soot matrix. We also say, well, how does this compare to other instruments that claim to measure mass of the aerosol? We compare it to a micro soot sensor. You'll notice that we get about 70% of the aerosol is soot or EC. Is measured by the micro soot sensor, so we know that there's other aerosol or other aerosol that's in the actual mix, because you're only looking at one part of the aerosol fraction with the micro soot sensor compared to EEPS. So nonetheless, they correlate very well, and that's pretty consistent with EC and OC measurements that have been reported in the literature, as well as other presentations comparing different methods, EEPS as well as DMM and others that measure size distributions. So we're pretty confident that the soot matrix is doing exactly what we'd expect it to do in this situation. I also wanted to, point out that, you're talking about still using that density factor of 2.3 in this calculation for both diesel and GDI engines, so that it's just clear that even if you go down below 1 mg/mi, you still have a very, very tight correlation. So the actual density factor calculation that's being used here, it seems to hold up well even at low concentrations. Some of you also are interested of employing the EEPS in regards to using the number concentration and compared to for PMP or particle number types of applications. So what we did here is that we went back and also did that bimodal fit, as we've talked before. But the idea here was that we just took the particles that were 23 nanometers and above with the EEPS and compared it with a solid particle number counting system. And remember, the 2 points I want to caution on the data here is that the EEPS was sampling from the CVS straight up by itself. It had no thermal conditioning on it. So it's straight off the CVS into the EEPS, measuring the size distribution and number concentration. The PMP, or solid particle number measurements, also measured from the CVS, but however, you're going through another thing of a dilution as well as a volatile particle remover, and then doing the number concentration as you normally would with particle number methodology. And we see a slight improvement between the default and EEPS 1.5 versus 1.4. So we know that we're sizing the particles correctly. We're not undersizing from that standpoint or undercounting. But what we do expect is that since we weren't using thermal conditioning in this situation, it's probably the overestimation comparative is due to that the 40% of those aerosol was liquid, so that would have been taken out by the volatile particle remover. So one of the next projects that we're going to do is actually rerun this type of experiment, but then also use some thermal conditioning, either a VPR or Calix stripper or whatever, and actually do that side-by-side comparison again and see how they compare up. So stay tuned for some further work there. But we know we're heading in the right direction using the soot matrix for the mass measurement, and then that will do some thermal conditioning and then actually look at the solid-to-solid, apples-to-apples comparison. So if you just, I try to visualize, you know, bring in some, you know, just how does this all line up comparatively from a looking at a concentration ratio, looking for a unity of one compared to SMPS versus EEPS using the different matrices. And what we do see is that for the compact matrix here in the concentration ratio, we do see the default versus SMPS to be a little slightly under the concentration unity of one from that standpoint. And also if you look at the comparative to the 3775, the compact aerosol, they seem to do a pretty good job of lining up with each other. But when you look at the soot matrix, you surely see the real differences. If you went with the default matrix, you see this huge difference in concentration as you go to bigger particles and a very low on the underside of standpoint compared to from a unity of one. If you use the new soot matrix, you see a much better, closer comparison to SMPS concentration versus EEPS concentration using the soot matrix on these types of aerosols. So this gives us a good confidence that we're make sure that we got the concentration right in these different types of matrices. But, you know, it never going to be one-to-one. There are two different methods, but this is a great step forward in looking at aerosols in from different types of combustion sources and using, you know, this one matrix that would apply to many different situations. So, to go back and use these matrices, with existing instrument that's out in the field, is great. Really allows the customer to actually do some post-processing of data down from past measurements and then apply it across the board. And then you don't have to have it come back to us and calibrate or anything else. You can actually use it right today and actually make those measurements. So when we look at some comparisons against some different sizing instruments, and this is some data that was presented by Southwest Research at last year's meeting in Cambridge, one of the things I wanted to point out here is that when we use the new soot matrix compared to a DMS-500, what we find here is that the EEPS is much closer to SMPS in size distribution. The SMPS here is in the dark line, and you got the soot EEPS is basically this orange line that's right here, and then you've got the DMS that's up over here, and we see a pretty marked difference in size and concentration between the DMS and the SMPS and the EEPS. The EEPS is much more closer to size and concentration compared to the EEPS. And then the other, if you look, that's on a number basis. If you look at it from a mass basis, there's a high degree of uncertainty looking at SMPS versus the DMS 500, specifically of particles larger than 560 nanometers. You can see this huge liftoff on the EEPS, the DMS 500 above these larger size particles, and where you've got the EEPS and the SMPS. Much more in alignment on those with those particles, but the DMS kind of takes right off and doesn't really know what to do. So probably need to it's because it's overestimating what the number and the size concentration is on a mass basis. So here's the question: which aerosol, the soot matrix, probably should be used regardless of engine type? That's pretty clear from some of the data that we've got so far. Those who want to actually look at the calibration of the EEPS or comparing it from a sizing and using monomodal type of aerosols, then we would recommend that you use the compact matrix so that you have a known aerosol. It's spherical or just near spherical in nature. That would be a better way to go if you're looking at from a calibration standpoint or from some comparison studies. So here's the question. Well, you know, I have got all this EEPS data out there. How do I reprocess some existing data? Well, with the new software, this is from the screenshot from the version 3.2 here. You have to have basically the raw instrument record saved with the software version 3.1 and or later, and then the firmware version 3.05 on your EEPS. So if you go back after this webinar and go look at the EEPS and, you know, check that you've got those right software versions and firmware versions. If you don't, let us know. We can work with you to get that updated. But those who already have those softwares and firmware revisions, then you're all good. All you'll need is the latest rev of the software, and you can do some post-processing of existing EEPS data and employing the new matrices. So how do you collect the data with the new matrix? You basically select the matrix in the properties menu. You pull it down as you normally would when you start a run, and what you'll see what the matrix is that you selected back in the lower left-hand corner here, and you got a dilution factor right next here, and so compact. So if you change it from default to compact, this is where it will say compact, or if you say it to soot, it'll say soot down in here. And then what's nice about it is when you collect this data using the new software is you can switch back and forth between the different matrices. You just basically go back in and select the properties tab of soot or default. If I go back here, this section right here on the properties new run, you just pull this down and under interest matrix, switch it from default to soot or whatever you want to do there, and then basically save it. And then when you look at the data again, it'll be processed, you know, using the soot matrix, and then you can export the data and go from there. So pretty simple, pretty straightforward. So made life a little bit easy for Maddie to go back and do some of this post-processing of the data, because it was all easy to do. So the question to you is then, well, how can I upgrade? Well, by attending today's webinar, we'll send you an email acknowledging your participation today. What we would ask you to do is send us a serial number of the EEPS instrument that you've got back to us. And then we'll send you a link to the new software for you to download and to use. Just a heads up on some requirements. You got to have Windows 7 or 8, at least a minimum, to run the new software. And then the EEPS firmware with version 3 or newer in order to run it. So those are the two criteria from that standpoint in looking at operation from a software basis. Some ongoing work, just to give you up, is that we've seen that improvement for a number of different engine configurations, although we see some slight inconsistencies that we want to try to drill into a little bit further. So if you have the ability to run an SMPS when you do some EEPS work, we certainly would like to know about that and to see how what your experiences are. So if you're willing to join in and participate, we certainly would appreciate it. Let me know. And then the other point is that there's some talk about whether these matrices need to be translated to the FMPS for doing environmental measurements. And we're not quite sure that it does just yet, because we're not seeing the pronounced differences on the FMPS compared to an SMPS under certain conditions. So that's still an unknown at this time, but we certainly are open to some discussions there and see if what people's experience are and see if there's a requirement. But so far it hasn't been as pronounced as you see it when actually sampling from the actual source of the aerosol itself. So conclusions, we have the new matrices developed for EEPS for basically agglomerated particles and using that empirical inversion. That inversion agrees quite well with SMPS as well as other literature data, resulting in a broader size distribution relative to the default matrix. And more importantly, we see some really good improvement in correlation to gravimetric with the integrated size distribution and mass mobility exponent for a density of a 2.3. That seems to run true across different types of aerosol sources. And then also when we looked at the solid particle number measurement, we're measuring it from a high standpoint, about 40%, but that's, as I said before, primarily due to that the aerosol was not thermally conditioned, and we're probably measuring some of the liquid fraction or volatile material comparative to a solid particle number measurement. And last, we have really good second-by-second capability of the EEPS for engine exhaust, especially for combustion modes that have high uncontrollability, like cold start, and looking at different fuel effects and injection pressures characterization. So using the new matrices, you can really drill into the characterization of those engine components as well as after-treatment and regeneration activities on DPFs, et cetera. If you want, I've added here in the presentation a number of different references that drill into this even to a deeper depth. In fact, I see that there's a question that came up about the effective density value, where it comes from. I can certainly share that with you. Send me a quick email and I'll give you some more details on that. But it's a pretty big derivation on the calculation of the 2.3 that Maddie's come up with. And you can find more information in these papers, especially Maddie's right at the top there, that actually goes through and does some derivation on how he comes up with 2.3. And then last, I just wanted to say, you know, thank you for listening. And there's more information on our website about the EEPS and the inversion matrices. There's app notes on the inversion matrix as well as some results. There's two big app notes. One is looking at the actual all those details in this presentation and some additional data that's supporting there, as well as the fundamentals on the inversion matrix. And there's a condensed version as well for those who don't need the full-blown detailed discussion but don't want to hit the high points of what they're really focused on. So other than that, I will open it up to some questions and we'll do some Q&A here. Does anybody have any other additional questions? Please add them to the chat area, and then I'll answer them as we go. Okay, I'm not seeing any questions, so unless there are if you think of something else after this webinar, my email is robert.anderson@tsi.com. Happy to answer any of the questions that come up in that. And I look forward to hearing from all of you in regards to your work with EEPS. And if there's no other questions, then I'll end the webinar. And I appreciate your time this morning, and hope you have a great weekend. Thank you.